So, actually, the history taking is an art, as you all know. And the biggest quality of a clinician is to have a good communication skill. Okay? That is very important so that we can build up a rapport with the patient. And that history taking is the art, I should say. So, at the end of this session, I want you people to know how to elicit history, what is the importance of history taking, how to approach the patient, and there are different parts of history like personal history, past history, so many things are there. And finally, we will move on to how to do obstetric examination. So, coming to the importance, see, when we take an accurate history, that is the very first step we are supposed to do. That will determine the entire problem, what is happening to the patient in any specialty. That is the dictum. And this will give a guide to clinical examination. Suppose the patient is having an acute pain and with the holding a tummy like that, when she enters an end girl, quickly we should rule out a torsion or appendicitis, something like that. So the history itself will give a clue how to proceed with examination. And 75% of the clinical diagnosis is made by the history itself. And this, as I already mentioned, it will build a rapport between the doctor and the patient. It's a very important interview like that. And we can identify the risk factor. From the family history itself, we can find out the risk factor. And we can arrive at a clinical provisional diagnosis. And that will direct a relevant investigation what to do, and that will lead on to appropriate treatment. Sometimes we need to have a follow-up and a counsel of a woman. That is the importance of this. But in obstetrics, they will be coming to us frequently. So even from at first visit and the subsequent visit, a detailed history should be taken, and that should be documented. Both history and the examination findings should be documented in the antenatal care so that a patient comes in emergency to labor ward. Some other doctor is going to be there. She can go through the entire document and she can assess whether she's a low-risk case or a high-risk case. That is the importance of history. So there are general principles how to take history. So we have to make the patient comfortable and you introduce yourself. You have to be very cordial. Be polite, and the privacy is very, very important. And it's better instead of asking, what why you came? That's a rude way of approaching. So if you go and ask, what's your name? What's your husband's name? What are you doing? How long you're married? That will help her to make her comfortable and she'll become less nervous. So sometimes, based on the history, see, this lady has got a deformity corrected. She will tell. See, her main complaint is 2 months amenorrhea. She has come for antenatal checkup. When you ask some detailed history, she reveals, or when you do examination, there is shortening of one limb. So what do you do after history, after examination? We may have to go back from routine and we do a special examination. For this patient, we have to make her a walk, and so that there is a tilting of pelvises there, depend upon the age where she got corrected. So there will be a tilting of pelvis, and we may have to do an extra measurement of length of the both limbs. So this is the importance of history and the physical examination. So the next thing, see, when we take a car out in the morning, what we check the fork, tire, whether it's all right, whether it's a flat, the pressure, everything, the brake, then only we switch on the engine. So as rightly said by Charlie, he says he is a believer of solving hard problems by using checklist. Otherwise, we will miss out. It's always, when we travel also, we must have a checklist. So it's always useful to have a checklist in taking the history also so that you won't miss out important things. And when you have this thing, you have to present it in a logical sequence. So when I looked at the components, see, it's not something like a medical history. So we have a little more complicated components. First, we should know the demographic data. and then the obstetric score of the patient, chief complaints, what first has come, marital menstrual history, present obstetric history, past obstetric history, contraceptive history, past medical, surgical, gynec history, family history, personal history, then only we will post on to examination. Don't go, as soon as the patient comes to Manchamaneira, go and do scan. Don't tell them. Please take some time to ask some complaint, some detailed history, then you start writing the investigation. Okay? So, now Apurva is there. Is Apurva is there, Prasanna?
Yes, ma'am, she is there.
Yeah. Can Apurva tell me what are all the initial demographic data will you record?
So we initially start with asking the name of the patient, and we proceed with asking
yes,
and from and what work she's doing at this occupation.
Yes.
And we also ask her, we get an estimate of her socioeconomic status.
Yes. Yes.
And we also ask her address.
Yes, that is fine. She has done it very nicely. That is how we have to take a
demographic
data. The occupation also is important because the patient may be a police lady, she is in the traffic standing for a long time, and even our pregnancy in residency, when a lady CRRM becomes pregnant and that too posted in labor ward, she may have to stand for a long time. Okay, so that may lead on to some problems. Radiology department, exposure to radiation, IT people, they are unable to come for checkup because of the shifts. Agriculture person, they are more prone for infestation. So the occupation part of it is very, very important. And the education also is important. When they are little educated, it is easy for them, for us to counsel and to comprehend certain things. And they will come for regular antenatal checkup, unlike when there is no formal education. That is the importance of demographic data. And how will you document all these details in the OP card? Tomorrow you are going to be another 4 months, you will be a CRRI. How are you going to document all this in the OP card? Yes, Apurva?
Yes, ma'am. So yes. We record the demographic data first.
Yes.
And then we write about her current pregnancy. So we mentioned about her para or gravida.
Wonderful.
And you also mentioned about her socioeconomic status.
Yes. Yes. Yeah.
And her obstetric score.
Yes. So she has done it nicely. So your first thing, you have to document the name, age, gravida, para, number of living children, abortions, if there is an abortion. So, and socioeconomic class, whether she is booked, immunized, and her LMP, based on LMP, you may write gestation age, 18 weeks or 32 weeks or 28 weeks, if she has a regular cycle. Okay, that is how when you start introduce the case in exam also, if you have this checklist, you won't miss out anything. Okay, so what will be the next? Okay, can Apurva introduce this case? Apurva? Or some panelists can introduce the case.
Yes, ma'am. Yeah. So a 36-year-old lady has come to the OPD with 60 days of amenorrhea with positive urine pregnancy test. The test was done by a private practitioner. She was not sure of her dates. So after some time, she says, for her first pregnancy, she was told that the baby was not all right at 9 weeks. And the second baby had aborted after completion of 4 months amenorrhea. For the third baby, she was told that the pregnancy was outside the uterus. And for the fourth baby, LSCS was done and the baby died after 3 days.
Okay. Now you tell me, what is her gravida? What is her para?
Yes, ma'am. So gravida is the number of pregnancy, including the current pregnancy. So since she is pregnant for the fifth time, her gravida will be 5. And whereas para is the number of delivered babies which have crossed the period of viability. And here it's only one, which is her fourth baby. So hence her para will be one. So gravida is one and para will be one.
Yeah, she has done it very nicely. She is a gravida five. She had two abortions and one ectopic and one LSES. And that too baby died. So we have to write, so when you introduce a case, so-and-so, socioeconomic, LMPs and that gravida, para, invariably many of us make mistakes, okay? So the para is nothing but number of birth delivered beyond 24 weeks or more than 500 grams, okay? It can be alive or dead. So this lady had a one LSES, two abortion, one ectopic. Ectopic and vesiclomol is included in the gravida, right? So that is why she will become gravida 5, para 1, living 0, abortion 2, and 1 ectopic gestation. Another example, they get confused because if a patient delivered triplet in first pregnancy and all alive, and she becomes pregnant next time, and that time also she will become second gravida, and but living children are para 3, living 3, right? So there shouldn't be any confusion in the basic thing. Okay, we'll move on to that. Apurva, she is worried about her age and she is concerned about that. How will you counsel? Why she is worried about it? Are you worried about it?
Yes, ma'am. Definitely because she is.
Why are we worried about it?
Because she is an elderly patient, ma'am, and she is also an elderly grand multi gravida. She is considering for the fifth time, and she also has two abortions, and she is also an obese patient, which is also mentioned later. So hence, obviously, we will be worried about her age because she is an elderly grand multi gravida.
Okay. What are the risks behind it? She is scared. Why are you scared?
Since she has no living baby and this is like her fifth pregnancy, so we will be, it's a precious pregnancy. But since because of her age, we will be worried for the chromosomal anomalies which the baby can present with. Okay. And we are also worried about, since she has a previous LSES section, which is a risk factor, so we will be worried about that. And since she had abortion in the second trimester, worried about
problem. When an elderly primy, after 35 years, we call them elderly primy. Okay, they have both maternal and fetal complications, right? So they are prone for abortion. They can have CPD because the last number vertebra can slip and the inlet will become, it is called sacralization of the lumbar vertebra. So the inlet will become reduced. So they are more prone for CPD. And because of the age, they are prone for diabetes, hypertension, preeclampsia, and it can be a superimposed preeclampsia. And because of preeclampsia, they can go for abruptio, exaggeration of the existing medical problems, increased incidence. The elderly primary go for prolonged pregnancy. So there may be a coexisting fibroid and a prolonged labor due to anxiety, increased chances of operative deliveries, and there is an incoordinate uterine action, failure of lactation, and they can go for, since there is a difficult of forceps or something like that, traumatic PPH also they are prone for. And she rightly said there are fetal complications like chromosomal or a fetal anomaly. They can go for fetal growth restriction, low birth weight, and preterm birth. And what is the importance of, similarly in extremes, elderly primary also, we get into problems. And in teenage pregnancy also, what are the teenage problems they can get? Teenage pregnancy.
Teenage pregnancy, they can the patient can have anemia. She's more prone to malnutrition, anemia. So hence, she can have CPD. And there is also increased chances of abortion in, and teenage pregnancy also, and higher risk of infections. And if she's belonging to a lower socioeconomic class, then definitely there will be increased risk.
They have a lot of anxiety, stress, they may not cooperate also, psychological problems. And they're also more prone to growth restriction, low birth weight. They all this extreme age, both maternal and fetal complications are more. Okay. So what about, he's not sure of her LMP. How are you going to assess that gestational age now?
So ma'am, she has come at 60 days of pregnancy. So since it's her first visit, we can proceed by taking a dating scan, which will give us an idea about her LMP. We can also, since she's in her second trimester, we can ask her about quickening and if she can perceive any fetal movements. And we can also hear the fetal heart rate.
So if the LMP is known, how are you going to calculate EDD? It's a simple thing, but just to recapitulate, if the LMP EDD, how do you calculate? So all of you know this. Another thing, corrected EDD. This is called corrected EDD. When it is irregular, maximum we can add 14 days. Okay, if once in for 60 days or something like that. Beyond that, there is no corrected EDD. And when we... the patient may conceive during lactation or then she conceived soon after stopping OCP, LMP may not be reliable. During lactation, she will have a lactation amenorrhea. During that, she would have conceived. In those cases, LMP is not reliable. When LMP is not known, the patient, sometime they can remember a single coitus or an induction of ovulation. When they take, then the LMP can be fixed. Or as she rightly said, we can do, if she has a record of dating scan or if she record of PV done in first trimester, we can assess the, from that we can calculate the gestational age. And sometimes the OPD, we use the Doppler. That can be pick up the case till 12 weeks itself, we can use a hand Doppler and we can find out the fetal heart. So as she rightly said, thickening. In primary, it comes little later, 22 weeks. In multi, it is 20 weeks. And you can see the fetal parts around 20 weeks or 18 weeks. From that, you can, probable gestational age, you can calculate even if it is, if you do not know LMP. Okay. So this is another important thing. It is very important thing when we deal a case of prolonged pregnancy. We call excellent dates when they are sure of a date, when there are OCP is not taken. Why we are asking this history? Because when they take OCP, the gonadotropin levels will be high. So we do not know what time that ovulation has occurred and what time she conceived. That is why we have to take a history of OCP. And when she has done an ultrasound around 16 to 20 weeks, and it should correspond to the gestational age. Then it becomes an excellent date. And sometimes we may not have this clinical correlation, but she would have taken two scans between 16 to 20 weeks, but that should correspond to the growth, the linear growth we can find out. So how far it is there, when it corresponds, that also we can consider as excellent. And when we say it is a good date, they will take a sure of dates, but they would have taken only one scan after 24 weeks, but that will correspond to the gestational age as per her LMP. When nothing is available, it is unreliable. So this is very important clue to find out whether she is going prolonged, crossing the dates and take a decision, okay? So what is the importance of other details we have collected, no? Socioeconomic class, booking, immunization, all that story. Why should we know? Yes?
So, yes, ma'am. So, socioeconomic status can help us know the nutrition of the patient, the cost and the availability for treatment of the patient, and how well the patient is taken care of, and the education of the patient will be based on that. If it is a booked or immunized case, we'll be able to track the case, and the tetanus toxoid immunization can be given to the patient at the first visit, and then 1 month prior.
or if the earlier pregnancy they had given it in 3 years' time, we can give one booster dose for tetanus toxin. Yes, so all that can be found.
Yeah, that is wonderful. And something more than what he said, we will add on. So in low socioeconomic groups, certain problems they are prone for. Not only for education, they are prone for preeclampsia, anemia because of malnutrition. Because of anemia and preeclampsia, they go for abruptio placenta, preterm labor, premature rupture of membranes. In low socioeconomic, more of rheumatic heart disease may prevail. And they may not come for antenatal checkup. They may not plan for family planning. Family support may not be there. So they are prone for growth restriction and intrauterine demise also. Similarly, in higher socioeconomic group, they are obese. They are prone for hypertension, diabetes, CPD, prolonged pregnancy, increased operative deliveries, postpartum hemorrhage, lactation failure, and macrosomy. So coming to the booking, the first visit, the first antenatal visit is called the booking visit. When you register, see this, our patient has come first visit, 2 months amenorrhea. To our hospital. That means that is the first booking visit. It has its own importance because you can identify the risk factors, you can give proper prenatal care, we can segregate who is high risk and requiring multi-specialty care. If she has a cardiac disease, we can ask the cardiologist to review the case and she will require a specialized care. So sometimes they may come without any problem. See, in a heart disease, grade 0, they are asymptomatic. When you go and auscultate, there will be a murmur. So these are all the importance of booking so that you can find out the risk factor, you can assess the gestation age and elicit detailed history, and you can perform in the first visit the baseline investigation like blood group, thyroid, blood sugar, everything. And what is the ideal? WHO says at specific intervals, the booking should be there. At least 4 visits and 8 to 12 weeks, there must be one visit. 24 to 26, another visit. 32 weeks and another week is 32 to 38 weeks. Why we should at least minimum 4 visits? Because in early pregnancy, we can segregate who requires a specialized care. So that certain signs, there will be a history of hemoglobinopathies in the family. Then we can screen and we can treat. Suppose she has a strong family history. But in India, in South India, even in first trimester, we screen for diabetes, GBM. So like that, and we can plan her whether she requires a frequent visit or not. And every visit, you must type and find out the maternal and fetal well-being, and you have to exclude preeclampsia, anemia, diet. We should counsel them about diet and the plan, and in emergency, where to come and how to reach the hospital. So they are focused. This is called the focused antenatal care model. Something like FNAC, it is FANC. It is called focused antenatal care model. Okay. So this is the ideal way. We always ask the patient to come in first up to 28 weeks, once in 4 weeks, 28 to 36 weeks, once in 2 weeks, 36 to 40 weeks weekly. Okay. So coming to the immunization, if we require to give 2 doses at least 4 to 6 weeks later, and if they have immunized 5 years before, there are no need. Within 5 years, no need to immunize. After 5 years, re-immunization. Now, we are all talking about even Government of India, even Government of Tamil Nadu, we are giving Tdap. That includes diphtheria also. And it should be given between 27 to 36 weeks. Even in FIGO, FOXI, they are recommending we can give influenza vaccine. In a case of prior RH gravidas, we should do ICT, indirect Coombs test, and give anti-D. And some special conditions we have to do immunization. When a patient is having, this is when you go to primary health center, there will be a lot of cases with the dog bite. So we have to give an inactivated virus, 6 doses, 0, 3, 7, 14, 30, 90 days after exposure. If the dog is rabidic, then you have to give immunoglobulin also. So when exposed to chickenpox, a pregnant lady can be given immunoglobulin, similarly hepatitis also. So these are all in the special cases for immunization. So don't waste time on menstrual history. You just wanted to get some message from whether it is regularity, frequency, and how to calculate. Don't keep on talking about moderate flow, soaks this much, this, all that story. Don't waste time. Just you find out whether how reliable the LMP and whether it is regular or not. So what is the history you will elicit in marital history? Yes, Prashant? Marital history?
Marital history, whether the marriage is consanguineous or non-consanguineous,
yes.
Firstly, and then specify the order of consanguinity. First order would be incest. Second order would be amongst maternal or paternal uncles. Mm-hmm. And third order would be a distant relative. So we go on for the order. And then how many years since they've been married, and if they've practiced any contraception or not before this pregnancy. And if they've practiced a contraception, then for how long and what mode of contraception they've taken up.
Yes.
And post all this, in the present pregnancy, whether they've been taking up any treatment for infertility, or if no treatment has been undertaken, then if it is a natural conception.
Okay, wonderful. That's enumerated everything. Good. So now coming to our case, what are the history will you elicit regarding the present pregnancy?
Ma'am, for the present pregnancy, yes, ma'am. For the present pregnancy, we go on to first ask the LMP and the EDD, ma'am. So the LMP, as the patient is not clear with her LMP, we then go on to predict the LMP using pervaginal examination, or maybe using the UPT, the urine pregnancy test, as to the date or the first date of her coitus, as the case may be, ma'am.
Okay, that is done. And okay, that's the history, that part of it, we finish. What other history will elicit? Yes, ma'am.
Ma'am, the first, yes, no ma'am, complaint. The first one. Yes, ma'am, for the first trimester history. So after the complaints have been elicited, if the patient has any, which would be 60 days of amenorrhea, we then go on to ask if the patient has confirmed it with the urine pregnancy test. And in this case, she has done it with the help of a private practitioner. So if she has confirmed it, whether a dating scan has been taken or not. And then with respect to the morning sickness, if she has been experiencing a morning sickness, or if there is hyperemesis gravidarum. After this, we then go on to elicit history on whether she has been booked or immunized. And if this is the first visit, then we go on for booking and immunization. And after that, we go on to elicit history on the investigations that are to be taken. So a blood grouping and typing is done, and a VDRL profile is taken up. Post this, we also look up if she has had any other complications with respect to the present pregnancy, such as bleeding PV or a discharge PV. So we ask history on that. And after that, we go on for a dating scan, ma'am, for the first trimester.
That is wonderful. And for this particular case, apart from the routine history like vomiting, whether she had vomiting, whether any urinary tract infection, whether history of spotting, unless if you don't elicit that, see, that is why it is called eliciting the history. They won't come out. They may not know the significance. They may have a spotting. They will not know the significance. Okay? So you have to elicit that. History, whether there is any history suggest of urinary tract infection, bleeding, spotting, then any exposure to some drugs, whether she's taking any drug, chronic drug, all that. But this particular case, if he has come after last childbirth, right? She has come,
yes,
after cesarean section. So how long? When second gravidar, third gravidar comes, you must ask how long after the last childbirth, whether she practiced some contraception, whether her period established after last cycle and whether it was regular. And of course, whether she conceived spontaneously or some drugs. And of course, for this particular case, because it is a little bad obstetric history, we should elicit the first visit itself, history of consanguineous marriage. So these are all the things we have enumerated already. We are not going into detail now. And what are the history also he has enumerated, like whether she has taken folic acid, fever, any other fever, infection, drug intake, all this nicely Prashant has enumerated. And the investigation part of it also he has informed us. So what are the common complaints for which they can seek medical advice in first trimester?
Ma'am, for the common complaints, the first would be a safe confinement of pregnancy.
No.
And they come in the third trimester. Ma'am, in the first trimester, it is complaints of amenorrhea.
Yes.
For a prolonged duration, probably a cycle being missed or a cycle or two being missed. And post that, it could be a bleeding PV or a spotting that they look up, ma'am. Mm. It could be discharge PV or a burning sensation that they encounter, which might be an indication of urinary tract infection. It could be a fever or an exanthematous fever for that concern, which they encounter in the first trimester due to torch infections. And post that, it could
torch
be...
only the rubella will give rash. Other things they don't have. Even dengue can give rashes. Our COVID can give rashes. So any fever, hyperpyrexia can kill the fever. And any drug, suppose she has a fever and she has taken some drug, what drug would validate? So she can come with a period of amenorrhea with some complaints. And the complaints, like any other case, we should assess what is the onset, duration, severity, relieving factors or exaggerating factors, and associated symptoms. See, the pain may be radiating or pain may be vomiting. She can still have appendicitis. She can still have cholecystitis. We shouldn't think only just because she's having amenorrhea. We should always keep our mind open. It can be due to pancreatitis. We think it is a severe gastritis. We have missed certain cases like that in OP. We thought it is a gastritis. The patient was given Gelusil. The next day she came with a severe pain radiating at the back, and it turned out to be pancreatitis. And all her enzymes were high. We have to transfer the case to surgical site. So all this is a routine. You must get into the habit of a pen habit. You should have the habit of asking. By the time she lie down on the couch, you should elicit all the history. Right? It will become your pen habit. Right? So these are all the things. Sometimes excessive salivation also, they can come, the burning sedation, the gastritis. The common complaint will have a gastritis. If you say they are very fussy about taking folic acid, all that. Okay? Vaginal discharge, bleeding, and backache also they can come. Oh, these are all the things. So what are all the probable complaints they can come to you in second and third trimester?
Third trimester, again, ma'am, for the second trimester, the patient can experience a bleeding PV or a discharge PV. So that is one. Maybe even a spotting. Other than that, again, complaints of burning sensation in the eyes, an epigastric pain, ma'am, or a pedal edema, all this can be indicative of preeclampsia.
Yes.
And apart from this, the patient can also
can come with diminished fetal movements. The common problem they can come to you is fetal edema, blood obstruction, epigastric pain, any pain abdomen, draining PV, and whether they perceive diminished fetal movement or a loss of fetal movement. Same thing. So if a woman complains of bleeding PV in second or third trimester, what history will elicit?
Ma'am, whether it's a painful bleeding that the patient experiences or a painless bleeding. So if it's a painful bleeding, then probably it could be abruptio placenta. And if it's a painless bleeding, it could be a placenta previa. So this is one history that we'll elicit, ma'am.
From the history, you can make a diagnosis. From the history itself, you can. And after second trimester, please ask three questions. By the time patient get ready for your examination, whether she perceives speech movement, draining or bleeding. These three things rules out so many things. So you have to find out whether it is the amount of bleeding, whether it is continuous or it's a spotting, what is the precipitating factors? You would have traveled a long distance or fell down from the bike or by the following a coil test. Whether she will have a spotting in the first trimester and she will again have a bleeding in the second trimester. It may be due to a dripping placenta near the arms. So that also, all this small little history will give a clue for your diagnosis. So fetal movements, don't forget after second trimester. So with so many complaints, they may not come with any complaint to you just for antenatal checkup, they will come. But even then, you have to routinely ask whether she is having any complaints so that she will come out, she will reveal then only. Okay, sometime she will get admitted in view of. See, in final year, people will give you previous LSCS case. She will do on 15 days later. So you can present the case like that. She has been admitted for safe confinement in view of previous LSCS, in view of multiple pregnancy, in view of preeclampsia. Okay, when you present, it will give a better idea that you know, you are like a professor, you are talking. So you have to say like that. But sometimes we will admit a patient who is on GDM on a diet, but we will readmit for investigation purpose, how she responds and whether we have to switch over to insulin. So these are all the basic things you have to do it. Okay, now we come back to the history. That history, I think it is a repetition. Okay, no, the history. So she doesn't have any complaint, but she comes for visit, second trimester. So these are all the history you should elicit, whether she is able to appreciate the fetal movements, and second trimester, you should ask whether she has taken already an immunization TT, or she has come back, an anomaly scan is done, and whether she is taking iron, folic acid, calcium, and you review. If she has not done first trimester glucose test, you have to do it and review all the available data. And sometimes we have to do indirect comb test also when a patient Rh gravida comes. The same thing, the third trimester, we have to find out the growth scan. And the growth scan and the chart, you should review it. Whether it is the birth curve is normal or it is below 10th percentile or 19th percentile. Get into the habit of asking the three common complaints you must ask. And you have to review all the old records, whether she is, the fetus is growing normal, and the fetal and maternal well-being you have to assess. So sometime we may have to ask the relevant question pertaining to her complaint. The history should be always pertinent to, and it should be relevant. Suppose she comes with 28 weeks and draining PV. You have to ask how long. The longer the duration, the sepsis rate is more. So from one, she is draining. That duration is very, very important. Whether it is associated with fever. She would have taken paracetamol. Nowadays, everyone is taking. And with the COVID, no one is going. No doctor is available. So she herself phone up and find out. And she will take paracetamol and come. So whether she has taken some drug, whether it is associated with fever, and whether she has traveled, and about the fetal movement. Sometimes we have to ask relevant history pertaining to the complaint. So coming to our case, she had one abortion. What are all the history pertaining to abortion you will elicit? Because she doesn't have any records at all, our friend. Yes, Prasanna, Prashant, Abhuva.
Yes, ma'am. So reason for the abortion, was it a spontaneous abortion or was it an elective abortion, the first abortion? And then if it was a spontaneous abortion, how was it? Was it a painless abortion, a missed abortion in a sense? And to relate to the obstetric history of abortion, after the first abortion, how long did she take to conceive the second time? The spacing between the two abortions,
yes,
can be asked me,
yeah,
in regard to abortion.
Fine, that's fine. But it is not an elective abortion. whether it is a medical termination of pregnancy, right? Don't use the word elective, because when they go for, when they desire to terminate pregnancy, it is called medical termination of pregnancy. And abortion can be spontaneous or induced sometimes. See this, when there is a no fetal heart, here can you see? There is no fetal heart raising at all in this scan. So there is a sac, so it can be a missed abortion. In that case, we advise them to go for medical termination of pregnancy. So that itself, see the early scan, you should ask, you should go and ask her that the scan was done. If the scan was there, whether the heart rate was, cardiac viability was there. Okay, so the viability of the thing we should know. Okay, if it is, there is no viable thing, then it must be a missed abortion. Missed abortion. Okay, so, and any history of preceding fever, urinary tract infection, trauma, or some drugs also, if she's on long-term drugs, that can itself can induce some abortion. Okay, so suppose so, and if there is a history of abortion, whether there is a sudden rupture of 16 weeks, second case, the second that lady is having a 16 weeks abortion. So in that case, whether the bleeding started first or the rupture of membrane and painless rupture of membrane and expulsion of the fetus is a gives a clue that it is a cervical incompetence. Okay, so. And how after abortion, whether it is a medical abortion or a surgical abortion. Nowadays, we give misoprost and mifepristone. That history also patient can give. I have not gone for anesthesia or this thing. I have given the tablet, so this thing. And post-operative period is very, very important, because they can go for sepsis. And is there any blood transfusion was given? All that history is very, very important. This he has touched upon, how long after abortion she has established the periods and how long after abortion she conceived. If a case of Rh gravida, we should elicit the history of anti-T, whether it was given. Okay. So these are all the things we should know about the abortion history. So this lady has got a previous LSCS also. What past history you will elicit? What are all the past history you will elicit?
Once again, if it also, yeah Prashant, you can.
Yes, Prashant. Yeah, so, Prashant is telling.
Ma'am, yeah, ma'am. Respect to the LSCS, we asked them what the indication was for the LSCS and if it was a recurring indication or if the indication is something new. As in this case, they've only tried out last time, so we'll have to elicit if it's a recurring indication such as contracted pelvis. And once we know the indication, we ask if vaginal delivery was attempted, if it was a prolonged delivery or not. And if the vaginal delivery had failed, then the reason for the same and which phase it had failed. And post that, if any rupture of membranes was instituted or not. And then going on the LSCS, what incision was given, and if the patient had developed any complications post LSCS, maybe a sepsis or a scar infection or a wound dehiscence, and the post-operative period about the birth of the child, if the child was born alive or not, and how the child fared, and if the child is alive or not.
Yeah, that is wonderful. It's almost lessened my burden. Actually, whether it is an elective LSCS or an emergency LSCS. And this contracted pelvis, it is a recurrent cause. The pelvis itself will be small. Then in that case, no point in doing VBAC. It will be very small. So we should know, the patient will tell us in their own language. It is a contract. So they told, see, when there is a contracted pelvis, we write and give the discharge summary. So other obstetric cause need not be a recurrent cause. CPD is not a recurrent cause. That particular baby would have been big, but this time it may be small also. Okay. And post-operative history of blood transfusion is very, very important. Post-operative infection, resuturing, hospital stay. All this indicates the nature of healing. Why we want to know all this history, which has happened 2 years ago, whether there is a urinary tract infection, distension, all that, that indicates the infection. So when there is an infection, wound healing may not be there. So the scar integrity may not be there. So we should know in this particular case, how long after last childbirth she has conceived again, so that we can plan for the next pregnancy, whether we can go for VBAC or not. So what history you can elicit if there is ectopic gestation, preterm, vesicular, suppose one case, in our case itself, ectopic gestation. So what history you would like to elicit? So in case of ectopic, again, we should know whether, am I audible? Prashant, am I audible?
Yes, ma'am. Now audible, yeah. Ma'am.
Suppose if it is in case of ectopic, we should know whether again there is a medical treatment, whether medical treatment was given, emergency laparoscopy or a laparotomy is done. And about if she is a case of RH lady, we should ask whether anti-D was given. And similarly, vesicular mole, what is the period of gestation and whether it was a surgical, it's always a surgical evacuation in case of a vesicular mole. How long she was followed up, what contraception she was advised, and after how many years she conceived, and the blood group also is very important in cases of vesicular mole. Coming to the history of preterm, we should know whether it is a spontaneous or a induced for the obstetric reason. See, in preeclampsia, we induce earlier. Suppose GDM on insulin, we don't wait for this thing till date. So, premature rupture of membranes. In all when you include that, it is that will precipitate urinary tract infection and IUGR, all premature rupture of membranes, they can go for preterm delivery. So we should know whether some antenatal corticosteroids was given and Maxalt was given, how long the baby was in NICU. If there is a past history of preterm, we should know how the baby's milestones are there now. See, we would have given a preterm baby alive, but the milestone, say, decerebrated rigidity and cerebral palsy. So the milestones of the baby, we should elicit that detailed history should be there. What detailed history you will ask? Suppose she had one vaginal delivery and postpartum period. What history you would like to elicit?
The duration of the delivery, whether yes. The vaginal delivery was induced or it was a spontaneous rupture of membranes.
Yes.
And then when she fed the baby immediately after delivery or 30 minutes, so the feeding history of the mother and the baby.
Yes.
And the recovery during the postpartum period, any postpartum complications of hemorrhage or fever. And after the prolonged period, when she retained back to her work and when she was able to go.
Yes, that is very important. So any history, you should take in depth, the normal delivery. So you cannot take it very light, whether it has happened in at term or preterm, or she has crossed the date. It can be the normal delivery, vaginal delivery can be a preterm, term or post-term. So any events during that intrapartum, any complications she had, and whether it is induced, how it was induced, like Foley's catheter or with the Dynaprost gel or with the tablets. And how long she was suffering, whether she was in the labor and there is a cesarean was done or she delivered normally or by a forceps or a vacuum. These are all the history will give a guidance to your subsequent management. So if the episiotomy is sutured, if suppose in a rural place, whether episiotomy was sutured or not, lacerations were there, and history of PPH, an RH negative woman, whether anti-D was given, all that story. So when you ask and conclude this normal delivery case, you should tell it's a full term. When you write it in the case sheet, it's a full term normal vaginal delivery, the baby weight, and some years ago, now her condition is alive and healthy. So that gives a clue about, that gives an information about, there is no complication. If there is a complication, you could have mentioned. So So you should know how to. So you should know how to put it in a nutshell also. But you must keep it in mind. All this history you should have elicited and then come to your conclusion. Right? Okay. So about the newborn, we should know something about the newborn, whether it's cried immediately, whether it was given to the baby, whether given to the mother, how immediately breastfed, he was rightly telling us, whether it was breastfed within half an hour or so, the weight of the baby, and suppose if it is a big baby, then this, and she is coming with the history of big baby, now present pregnancy, you have to try to rule out GDM. If there is a case of intrauterine death, you should know whether it's a fresh death or a macerated death or anomaly fetus. Sometimes we do fetal autopsy also, fetal echo. I mean, I suppose the baby died after 2 days. They will definitely do fetal echo or echo of the baby, x-ray, fetal autopsy. All the history, unless you elicit, they won't come. They will keep it in a corner, and from the back, they will slowly take it out and show it to you. Especially, we have to be very careful when there is a previous history of intrauterine death. You should know whether it is a stillbirth or a macerated, fresh death or a macerated death, because the subsequent management depends upon the past history. And the postpartum period, he was correctly telling, the prasanna was rightly telling about the infection, fever, urinary tract infection, deep vein thrombosis. Our patients more prone for deep vein thrombosis because in postnatal ward, they won't eat water. They won't drink water. They won't move around. Basically, they are anemic. They are more prone for deep vein thrombosis. Okay. So lactation also, all the details already prasanna has given, but sometime there will be a history of sore nipple or retracted nipple and breast abscess. So it may be, and the retracted nipple still will be present. So we should look for that. Okay. So all this history you have to keep places. So coming to the past medical history, it is very, very, very important, because any underlying medical disorder will have an impact on the pregnancy, and the pregnancy will have an impact on the medical disorder. And the drugs given also have an impact on the fetus, and the course of the pregnancy can worsen also. So the past medical history is very, very important. We have to take whether the patient is already taking insulin or a oral antidiabetic, heart disease, whether she has a prosthesis, pacemaker, or an open heart surgery, hyperthyroidism drugs. And when the patient comes to you, an epileptic patient, we have to switch over to monotherapy. So what drug she is taking, we should know. And invariably, they will come with mother-in-law. They will hide some drugs. They will not tell us, especially the thyroid, they won't tell us. And antipsychotic drug, when they are on, they won't tell us. Asthma, they won't tell us. See, we will ask in front of mother-in-law, Emma, Adavdu, they will say, no doctor. Then on the table, she will tell us, she will have an acute exacerbation of asthma, and she will, asthma varum doctor, she will tell. So we have to have the checklist. Routinely, you have to ask, okay? So that when there is a history suggestive of lupus erythematosus, skin lesion, and other things, there, the fetal bradycardia is more common for them. So this is any chronic illness you should elicit. See, we are seeing lot of kidney transplant patients are coming to us. So unless they open out and unless we ask something, they will not tell us. And of course, the past surgical history also is very important, because sometimes we may not able to see the scar. It can be intra-umbilical. There may be a lap cystectomy, lap cholecystectomy, luckily. So routinely get into the habit of asking past surgical history. See, she would have underwent her spine surgery at the age of 14 or something like that. In that case, her pelvis will be altered. So get into the, see, this all this scar will not be seen at all. Even when you do examination, sometimes it may not be seen. Intra-umbilical scar may not be seen. So routinely get into VVF repair, previous VVF repair they would have done for the heels. See, there is no scar at all, the vaginal surgery. So you have to get into the habit of asking. So coming to the family history, he has already mentioned about the this thing, history of multiple gestation, history of anomalies in the siblings. See, the two siblings are having anomalies. So the third one, they aborted, they wanted a medical termination. See, look at this. This is a autosomal dominant disease. Of course, we talked about contraceptive history. Don't forget about contraceptive, because there is the contraception can interfere with the ovulation. So other contraception, we may not be that much interested. So the personal history is very, very important in case of obstetrics. The history of alcohol can lead on to fetal alcoholic syndrome. Smoking can lead on to fetal growth restriction. And apart from routine, your sleep and other things, we should ask every visit about the diet of the patient so that we can rule out some dietary deficiency. Okay, so coming to the physical examination. The physical examination is little different from compared to other physical examination. It is little, you need to have a patience, you have to have a skill, and the male, suppose if you, one of you, Prasanna or Prasant, is going to become a gynecologist, you have to have one female attender with you. That is very essential. Privacy is important. So, yes, Apurva, if you are not talking for a long time, what are the general examination will you do? And suppose her BMI is 31, what advice will you give? Apurva is there?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. Tell me, what general examination?
So for general examination, we'll start with measuring the stature of the patient. We'll assess her nutrition. So short stature is it's the category of high risk pregnancy. Mm. And also for nourishment, we will see about her build, if she's thin or moderately built. And that will also give us a clue about her obesity status in this case. Then we'll move on to measuring her BMI. So here it is said that her BMI is 31 kg per million for her height. 31, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. Her BMI, according to the classification, is considered to be obese. That is, any value above 30 kg per millimeter square is considered obese. So in this patient, we will recommend her to restrict her calorie intake, and we will also suggest her that she should limit her weight gain during pregnancy. So normal weight gain during pregnancy is around 10 to 12 kg, but since her BMI is 31 kg,
7 kg.
Limit her weight gain to 7 kg. So that will reduce the chances of developing gestational diabetes mellitus, because she already has a high risk for developing GDM. And then we will proceed with measuring, then we'll proceed with looking at the signs. So we will look for anemia, we will look for pallor in her lower palpebral conjunctiva, in her tongue, the tip of her tongue, in her nail beds, which will also give a clue if she has anemia or not. Then we will progress with looking for jaundice in the upper palpebral conjunctiva, and also we will look at the tongue and also the inner mucous membranes of the mouth. And then we will look for cyanosis. So we have peripheral and central cyanosis. Peripheral cyanosis, we can look at the tip of the nose, the tip of the ear lobules, and also your tip of your fingers. And central cyanosis, we will look at the tongue of the patient. And then then we'll also look at edema, if she has any edema. So normally physiological edema is considered to be physiological in pregnancy, but it is usually relieved after 12 hours of rest. So if it persists after that, then it is considered to be pathological.
So she rightly said about the height, weight, and gait. See, it's very rhyming. Height, weight, gait. Okay. Always in primary, we should check the spines. Right. Short stature. See, this girl, this woman is 3 feet. She's a dwarf, the smallest pregnant woman who delivered. See, sometime we will not know. See, this lady is having an artificial limb. When they walk, when they enter the consultation room, we may not be able to look all these things. But when we make them lie down, we find out all these things. So, and there is, so weight gain, you rightly said, for normal 10 to 11 kg underweight, we can advise 12 to 14. Obese 8 kg. When the BMI is high, from that BMI itself, you know this lady is going to go for diabetes, hypertension, preterm, miscarriages, and when it is very low BMI, they go for low birth weight. So this is who everyone is writing in the case sheet. Apurva, if you remember this, you will not miss out. Okay. So pedo, icterus, cyanosis, clubbing, lymphadenopathy. Sometimes, see, we may get a gastric carcinoma patient becoming pregnant. In that case, sometimes lymph nodes will be palpable. Or tuberculosis patient. See, the other day, the doctor was discussing tuberculosis pneumothorax patient. Postnatally, she died. Okay, so get into the habit of seeing all the things from head to foot. That is the dictum. From head to foot, you have to do. Don't skip anything. You will miss out something. Okay. So sometimes, since she was talking about physiological edema, that will disappear after 12 hours of rest. It is usually seen in third trimester, and it is around the ankle. It is only in the dependent part. When it is there in the non-dependent, in vulva, hand, and anterior abdominal wall, you should suspect preeclampsia. Okay. Mostly, and it is not accompanied by diminished urine output. The reasons for physiological edema, it is physiological, that is why it disappears. The pressure on IVC, vasodilatation due to progesterone, change in colloid hydrostatic pressure, and sodium water retention due to estrogen and progesterone, increase in aldosterone. This common question they will be asking, the reason for physiological edema. Okay, so sometimes this teeth also we are supposed to look for. The gums, the teeth, the nail, the brittle nail indicates malnourishment. Sometimes the choelenichia. See the very sight, it is exophthalmos. It indicates hyperthyroidism, acanthosis nigricans. She is more prone for GDM. See, this is almost physiological sometimes, but this specific thyroid, we have to get a consultation with thyroid, whether it's autoimmune or goiter or something like that. So general examination gives a clue for further investigation and examination. So don't forget about breast examination. The antenatal, we have to rule out thyroid breast examination. So when there may be a slight milk secretion or colostrum, that indicates either a growth restriction or intrauterine death. And sometimes we may come across with a lump. That is a sort of a screening thing. It's an opportunistic screening. When we this thing, the patient CM, that is the need for booking. The symptomless, we can pick up. So when we palpate, there may be a lump. So we can do further investigation. And the retracted nipple, I told you, that should be kept in mind during lactation when we deliver. All that is breast examination. These are all the things we have to look for. Okay. And other, coming to the examination, after general examination and blood pressure, see, when you become house surgeon, sometimes you may not keep the blood pressure at the heart level. At the various positions they are taking at the convenience, that should not be there. And the of obstetric exam. The basic steps in and come, patient should be explained and all gentle, and you should stand on, doctor should be accompanied by a female attendant in a box position and a semi-flex, and you should nicely cover it up to this, and the space between zippy sternum and the pubic symphysis should be exposed. Other parts should be covered nicely. So coming to this inspection, see, you can very well see this is a transversely enlarged uterus. This is a longitudinally enlarged uterus. That means it is a cephalic or a breech presentation. When it is transversely enlarged, that means it may be a transverse light. Okay, this is around 32 to 34 weeks. Okay, that gives a clue that you are going to have a transverse light patient, right? So inspection gives a lot of information. Okay, and other things you have to describe in a case of exam, the stria gravida. It is nothing but the rupture of elastic fibers due to stretching. And this stria albicans is a white thing. It's due to previous pregnancy.
Your bandwidth is too low. Can you try switching off the video and speaking on audio for some time?
Am I audible?
Yeah, yes, ma'am, you are audible. You can turn off your video and share your screen, and we can have that one because of the low bandwidth.
Audible?
Yes, ma'am, you are audible. We are not able to see your screen. Yes, ma'am, we are.
That is mine. Okay,
you can try turning off your video, ma'am. Yeah, you're audible, ma'am. You can try turning off your video. That will help with the bandwidth. We can have the slide and your voice.
Am I audible, isn't it? Right. Okay. So this umbilicus averting is due to the distension. But this
we are not able to see your screen, ma'am.
Pardon? You're not able
we are
to
not
see
able to see your slide? You have not started your screen sharing.
No, are you able to see?
We are not able to see your slides.
Slides, okay. I will share again.
Yeah, sure.
Able to see?
Yes, ma'am. Starting. Yeah, we are.
So the previous things which I was showing of no clinical importance, but they will ask. Edema. It can be an occipital posterior position or a extended breech. And whenever there is a scar, you should describe whether it is a healthy or an unhealthy, and sometimes this transverse scar will be hidden on the pubic hairline. So you have to be very careful. So any incisional hernia, keloid, all those things you should you should see for in the inspection. So coming to the method, how we are supposed to do the examination. With the right hand, and the dextral rotation is due to the sigmoid colon. So height of the fundus you have to assess first with the ulnar border of the left hand by moving the left hand downwards from Zipf's sternum. Okay. So, and when you reach the highest point, that is the resistance, that is the slowly you have to ulnar border, you have to bring it from Zipf's sternum to here. When you feel the resistance here, that is the height of the uterus. You have to mark. Okay, when you have to take the measurement later on, symphysio-fundal height. Okay. So the coming, see, these are all the we have finished inspection, palpation, the fundal height we should remark, and the height of the uterus depends upon the period of gestation. So arbitrarily it is divided from pubic symphysis to umbilicus. It is divided into three equal parts at the level around 24 weeks. From 24 above, it is 32 weeks. So the first line indicates 16 weeks, 20 weeks, and that level of umbilicus is 24 weeks. And similarly, that upper part is divided into three equal parts. So it is 8 weeks, 32 weeks, 36 weeks, and it falls back with the flanks at 32 weeks. So you should remember that when you palpate. Next thing will be the Leopold's maneuver. You know, he has established this around 1884, still practicing how great he is. And usually it is effective after 28 weeks. Before that, it is not valid because it's going to change the position. The heart, the fetus is going to change the position. Okay. Am I audible, Prasanna? Am I audible?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. You are audible.
Okay. Right. I have not seen. My video is not there.
Yes, ma'am. Your video is off. If your bandwidth is good now, you can start your video.
I don't know. Where is it?
You can start your video and see, ma'am. If it gets stuck, then you can turn it off. Yeah, we are able to see.
I'm getting worried that everything will go flat. Okay, so that Leopold's is usually done after 28 weeks. Before that doesn't have any meaning. So the fundus, we've already ascertained the height of the uterus. Then the first thing is the fundal grip. So with the two hands, you assess the fetus. This is to find out which part of the fetus is occupying the fundus of the uterus. And you see, all know, the breech is the soft, broad mass which does not have independent ballotability. If it is a round, hard mass which has got individual, of course, the head is going to ballotable. That means it is a head. But in certain conditions, these maneuvers are very difficult to do in case of obesity, polyhydramnias, in primates when they have a tight abdominal wall and very uncooperative patients. So we finished fundal height, fundal grip. The next will be the umbilical grip. So the umbilical grip on either side of the uterus, you keep it. So when you see it, well, that means that side is the back. When you feel the multiple fetal parts on the other side, that means it is the limb buds. And the third important grip is the first pelvic grip, is also called pavlic grip. That should be done by ulnar border of the right hand, and you have to cup your hand between the cup right hand with the thumb on one side and the other fingers on the opposite side. You have to keep your fingers like that, okay? And you can grip the fetal part which is occupying the lower pole. If you use like this, if your hand like this, then you can very easily palpate that. This also find out what is actually all this grip will find out, help us to find out lie and the presentation. The lie of the fetus and the presentation of the heart. It is, when it is hard, that means it is scared, it is broad, soft, it is breech. If this grip, sometime in a transverse lie, you cannot feel the grip at all. That means it is a transverse lie. So that's about the first pelvic grip. It is called Pavlik's grip. So the coming to the second pelvic grip, all the while we were facing the patient's face. Now you will turn to your patient's feet. You have to face the patient's feet. The purpose of four fingers of both hands are placed on either side of the lower abdomen and a deep palpation is made towards the direction of the pelvis. The fingers on one hand will palpate the occiput, the other hand will palpate the sinciput. So this is, has got a special meaning, second pelvic grip. So the purpose is to confirm the first pelvic grip and to find out, because your finger on one side is palpating the sinciput, the other hand is palpating the occiput. So you will find out whether the head is engaged or not. And you find out the attitude of the head, whether it's a well-flexed, deflexed or extended. And to some extent, we can find out whether it is, there is a CPD. So, but don't go and tell when the head is floating, you will not allow to. It has no meaning in it. We will not do the second pelvic grip when the head is floating. Okay. So this is the thing I was talking to you, whether it is a attitude, whether it is a well-flexed. Well-flexed, it is the occiput is at lower level, the sinciput is at higher level. In a deflexed head, it is almost at the same level. This can be easily felt by your both hands. And so, and by second pelvic grip, we know whether its head is engaged or not. When the divergence of the finger, when it diverges, that means the head is inside, it is engaged. When it is converged, it is not engaged. So this is something it's equivalent to that. When there is a cup and the egg is there, use egg cup and the egg, it is head is engaged, it is nicely inside. When it is just entering into the pelvis, it is not, it is only fixed, it is not engaged. Fixed means it's just entering into the pelvis. Engaged means it is entered into the pelvis and it is at the level of ischial spines. So the part of the head is not felt, so it is diverged. And when it is converged, it is unengaged. So this is the cephalic presentation with a different attitude. We can find out one is, see, by Pavlik Leopold's maneuver, we can find out lie of the fetus and the attitude of the fetus. So when it is well flexed, it is like that. When it is deflexed, it is occipital posterior. When slightly extended, it can be a bro. Fully extended, it will become a face presentation. Okay. So auscultation, all know, can be done. If it is a occipital posterior or anterior, it will be in the spino-umbilical region on a one side of the back. In occipital posterior, is more towards the flank because it's a military attitude. The spine of the fetus and the spine of the mother is in same line. That is why occipital posterior happens. So it will be heard in the flank. In transverse lie, it is heard below the, at the level of umbilicus. In breech, it is heard above the level of umbilicus. Of course, in multiple gestation, two doctors have to observe and there should be a difference of 10 weeks. Either you can use fetoscope or a stethoscope. Percussion is not usually, we don't do in routine practice, but it is indicated when you suspect polyhydramnios. So sometimes the patient can have cirrhotic liver and there is an ascites also in addition to that. In HELLP syndrome, sometimes they develop ascites. So when it is over distended, tiny and stretched, you have to find out a fluid thrill. That can be done, the attender or whoever it is, or sometimes we can ask the patient to keep the hand also. So they will keep it in front the examiner will keep both the hands on either side at the same level and tap it and find out whether there is a fluid through. So other findings, what we always see is shelving sign. It is nothing but it's of no clinical. That is, to some extent, that means it has come down. It is nicely getting into the pelvis, but not much of clinical significance. So the mother sits due to falling forward of the uterus. She nicely keeping it. The examiner also can keep the hand like that, but this lady is keeping nicely as a shelving sign. And of course, at near term, you have to find out whether uterus is contracting, relaxing, amount of liquor and baby, size of the baby. So this is a very important point, because most of the time they make a mistake. It is a symphysio-fundal height, it's a misnomer. We have to take the measurement, you fix the height of the uterus from the, fix the tape there and then take the measurement down, face down, okay? Invariably, because it is a symphysio-fundal height, they always think we have to take measurement from, it is a fixed point, so no point. It's very easy to keep the tape. Only the fundus, it is not fixed point. You have to assess the fundal height, keep the tape there and then measure it, okay? And after 20 weeks, it corresponds with the gestational age. Either plus or minus 2 centimeters is allowed, it corresponds to gestation age. More than discrepancy of 4 centimeters, either above or below, you have to suspect if it is less. Wrong dates, intrauterine demise, transverse lie, oligohydramnios, growth restriction. If it is more, you have to think in terms of wrong dates, big baby, pregnancy with maternal ascites, tumor complicating pregnancy. And it increases 1 centimeter per week till 36 weeks. So abdominal girth, again, we measure it after 30 weeks. And it corresponds to the gestational age in inches. Okay, this also increases 1 inch per week or 2.5 centimeter per week. At term, it is 100 centimeter. These are all the indirect way to find out whether the growth is normal, whether it's appropriate, all that. It is simple examination, simple measurement tell us the growth is appropriate. That is called the gestational age and the symphysio-fundal height. If it is correspond, see this, this lady, this graph is not, it was so well, it is still 34 weeks, it was corresponding. After that, it was falling. So you have to suspect late onset fetal growth restriction, okay? So the last one is the fetal weight, not last one. We have to assess the fetal weight also is a part of examination. There are two methods to assess the weight. One is Johnson's rule, the other one is McDonald's rule. In Johnson's rule, if it is unengaged, fundal height minus 12 into 150 is fundus in centimeter into 2 divided by 7. It will give in duration of lunar months. By into 8.7 will give in weeks. So you can assess the, without even scan, you can assess to some extent the fetal height. The next will be the pelvic assessment. We have to do pelvic assessment whether that particular baby is going to deliver through that particular pelvis. So how do we assess, especially in case of preemie? So this will be after evacuation. Waiting after she passes urine, we can do it by manual examination and with the middle and the east finger. First, we have to reach the sacral formantium, whether it is reached or not. If it is prominent, that means the inlet is not all right. Then the curve of Caris, that is the sacral base. It should be backwards and forwards. That should be curved. The coccyx should be mobile or tip. Then will be the sacrosciatic notch. We sway like that. Then we'll come to sacrosciatic notch. Then the side walls. It should be parallel. It shouldn't be convergent. And then it is, you see, all this gives a clue about inlet. The promontory, the coccyx, the sacrum, sacrosciatic notch and the pelvic side walls. Then about the mid cavity, the ischial spines. We should, when the spines are reached, when fingers are, shouldn't reach actually. When it is, should not reach, that means it must be 10 centimeter. Then comes to the outlet. The pubic arch should be well curved, and the ischial subrachity should admit 4 knuckles. If it is, the pubic arch is like this, it is contracted, it should be like that, obtuse. If it is like that, it means the contracted pelvis. So by abdominal palpation, if, after doing abdominal palpation, Lippert's maneuver, pelvic examination, at the same time we can assess the CPD also. The ideal time to do CPD is at the onset of labor. So the index and middle finger already is in the vagina, and the right hand are kept in the vagina at the level of ischial spines, and the right thumb over the pubic symphysis, and the left hand try to push the head into the pelvis downwards. If the head goes in, there is no CPD. If it is flush, that means there is a minor CPD. If it is overriding, that means it is a major degree. So these are all the things. Apurva, we have finished everything. History, examination. How will you summarize the case? How will we summarize the case? Because sometime when in your how are you going to summarize the case? Okay. It's not a big deal at all. You've discussed everything. So you will start with her name. She's coming from such and such a place. She's a IT professional. She's a gravida, para, and she has come with 5 months amenorrhea for antenatal checkup. Suppose she has some positive history in the previous pregnancy. Then you mention about it. Suppose she has come for some complaint, that also you have to mention. Then any positive findings in general examination and your obstetric examination. And when you review the case, if there is any investigation which is abnormal, you will tell. Okay, that is how you have a fight on examination. She's not anemic, no pupil edema, nothing, no specific complaint for 20 weeks. This thing, no, except for her bad obstetric history, it corresponds to the period of amenorrhea. Her blood pressure is normal. Her investigation, her anomaly scan is normal. That ends the, her hemoglobin, everything is normal. So sometime they will ask you, if you are a last candidate, no, 24th candidate in the exam. So what they will ask is diagnosis. Okay, from that they will dig your grave. Gravida 5, para 1, living 0. Her expected date is by scan is 20th of July, and it's a single live fetus. FH is good in a cephalic presentation. Yes, now you understood what is the difference between summarizing and diagnosis. That should be that. So to conclude, I will put a larger screen. Where is it? Yeah, see, my this thing is seen? Not seen? My PowerPoint is seen?
Yes, ma'am. You are able to see.
You are able to see? Okay.
Yes, ma'am. Right.
So this is like that. To climb the top of the mountain, sharp mountain, we need a broad base steps. So the basement is a detailed history, present, past, menstrual, personal, family history, all that. You have to take a detailed history is very, very important. Basement should be strong, okay? Body shouldn't be weak. Basement should be strong. So detailed history is the fundamental which will give you clue So you have to review the available records, your physical examination, both abdominal and PV also is essential to arrive at a diagnosis. This will give you an appropriate decision making, whether to allow for vaginal birth, whether to take up for elective LSES, all that. That is very important. So I want to conclude with this. Attention and focus are essential skills for taking clinical examination and essentials. Learn, you will have more. So the question and the questions. So I'm taking to light, people are walking here. This is an American side. Okay. The ability to learn is deliberate practice. So basic skills of history taking and physical examination, one can be easily acquired by examination of patients with different clinical conditions, theory knowledge. And that, I thank you all. Stay home, stay safe.